Good morning. What an extraordinary crowd, and it's really great to see everyone here. It's great to see, I only arrived for the last presentation, unfortunately. Great to see British innovation in action and generating fantastic new products for patients. That's what we do. For those of you who haven't been reading newspapers for the last couple of years and aren't aware of the advances in immuno-oncology, it really is a transformation in cancer care. So cancer care in the past, and even now, is quite brutal. It involves really the use of ever more sophisticated poisons, essentially, to inhibit the growth of fast-growing cells. And whilst it's been known for decades that the immune system was in some way involved in the control of malignant cells and cancer, no one's been able to get a handle on it until recent years. And the whole idea of the immuno-oncology approach is you can engage your own immune system and re-educate it in some way to eliminate the cancer, because that's what it normally does when you're healthy, and particularly when you're young. The immune system detects a malignant cell, a mutant cell, and eliminates it. And as you get older, it's not so good at doing that. So what everyone within this field is trying to do is better understand the immune system and then use it to control the cancer, and we're in that field. And very specifically, we're in the cancer vaccine field. So this is the usual disclaimer, which I'm sure you will read very carefully as a public company. So this is just an initial summary of what we do. We are a clinical stage immuno-oncology company. Our technology platforms are two. One is called Immunobody. I will try not to be too technical, incidentally. One is called Immunobody, and that is clinical stage. And both of these platforms are genuine platforms from which many different products can emerge. And the Immunobody platform is actually a DNA vaccine platform. And one of the great advantages of what we are doing is the ability to combine this with other treatments in cancer, and that's one of the typical ways that cancer is treated. The second platform is called Modytope. Modytope is, again, completely innovative. It involves another means of stimulating the immune system. That's preclinical at this stage, and we've seen some very dramatic results in animal studies. So what is driving the valuation of the company at this point is our lead clinical product. That's the nature of biotech companies. Most value is ascribed to clinical assets. And so one of the great uplifts in value that we hope to achieve is achieving clinical validation for the second platform, the Modytope platform, which we'll be getting over the next couple of years. So if you've been following Scancell, you will know that our first immunobody is called SCIB1, Scancell Immunobody 1, and that's being used for the treatment of melanoma. Melanoma is the most virulent form of skin cancer. It's a malignant mole. And it's one of those diseases that's, it's a paradox in a way. It's very easy to treat and very hard to treat. It's easy to treat in some cases because you can see it. And that's not the case for many cancers. You don't, for pancreatic cancer, for example, you don't know what's going on until it's very advanced, and often it's too late. At least with skin cancer, you can see it. And if you see an abnormal mole, you go along to your doctor, and if you do it rapidly, it can be excised and you're cured, and that's a complete cure. Unfortunately, most people are afraid of doctors, and they don't go until it's got it perhaps ulcerated or it's bleeding, and at that point, if it's gone to a depth of more than 2 millimeters, it will metastasize in many cases, and once it's metastasized, it's gone to the lymph nodes, and even worse, it goes to other parts of the skin, and even worse than that, it goes to visceral organs like the lungs and the brain. And once it's gone there, it's very, very difficult to treat indeed. And if you do a post-mortem on an advanced melanoma patient, the lungs, for example, very often look like there's black dots all over them. It's not lung cancer, it's melanoma cancers within the lung. So it's a very hard to treat condition unless you get it early. We have developed a technology which is proving extraordinarily successful in a particular segment of these patients. These are late-stage patients who at the moment will have the surgeon excise the primary tumor, and all you can do with those patients at the moment is send them home to watch and wait. There is no other treatment available, and they have a very high chance of relapse, and our data is showing that many, if not the, most of these patients are living for very long periods without disease, and that's the really exciting story about SCIB1. It's very easy to manufacture, it's simple to administer, it's very safe. I mean, I was very interested to hear about the contrast between the UK and the US in terms of valuation. We're very conscious of that too, and within the last 12 months, we've been very focused on broadening our profile in the United States. And that doesn't just mean going over there, it means engaging with key opinion leaders. And the next step for us is to go forward into another much larger study, which will be US orientated. We form relationships with key opinion leaders in melanoma in the United States. And in the United States in particular, that relationship with key opinion leaders will then lead to advocacy groups. Advocacy groups are very important in the United States, influencing regulators and pharmaceutical companies, investors, and everybody else, all the stakeholders involved in the business. And as we've moved towards the US market, in terms of getting better known, it's already beginning to pay dividends. So we will embark on this very important new study in the United States, which will start in 2017. And at that point, we hope to take advantage of the arbitrage between UK and US valuations and achieve some of the results that Peter wants to achieve. It's also very important, if you can, in cancer, to try to identify patients who are most likely to respond ahead of time. The compounds that are currently approved in immuno-oncology are called checkpoint inhibitors. You see news about them in the press from time to time. They only work in 30% of patients, and they cost $100,000 per patient. And you cannot predict ahead of time which patient will respond. So effectively, you're paying $300,000 per patient who responds. So there's a tremendous effort in any oncology indication with any oncology drug to get alongside what's called a companion diagnostic to try and predict ahead of time which patients will respond the best. And we've done some work with a French company called ImmuneID, which I haven't got time to go into the details of, but which we reported a couple of months ago, which suggests that we may be able to do that with SCIB1. Major upcoming milestones, we've got a 35-patient trial, which we have been reporting continuously, which will be reported in full towards the middle of this year. And we will start this major US trial in 2017 in combination with a checkpoint inhibitor, which will read out in 2018. So we think within that period, with our lead product, there will be a substantial uplift in valuation associated with ImmunoBody. The whole thing is supported by very strong IP. It's all Scancell discoveries. We own everything, and we have strong intellectual property around both platforms. And unfortunately, we've all been around quite a long time, so we really know the business. My background is Astra and UK biotech companies, and I've been involved in both clinical trials, marketing, and running businesses. So I hope we know what we are doing. Let me go down into a little more detail about the clinical results with SCIB1, because that's what's driving things. First of all, if anyone's interested in technology, I just wanted to say something about a unique mechanism of action, because that defines the intellectual property. So you don't have to understand very much about this, except to know that we are generating very highly avid T cells directed specifically against particular cancer we're targeting. So in case of SCIB1, it's melanoma, and it's the T cells that go out and patrol the body. You generate them in a muscle. They go out and patrol the body, searching for malignant cells and hopefully destroy them. So the better T cells you can generate, the better product. And all our screening procedures were about defining a combination of technologies that got the best T cells. And that was ImmunoBody, presented as a DNA plasmid delivered by something called electroporation. And electroporation is a new technology. We think you're going to hear much more about it in the future, which involves passing an electric current across a muscle as you inject. And what that does is create a transient porosity in the cells you're targeting so that the DNA concentrates in those cells at 100 to 1,000 times greater concentration than you otherwise would. So this combination of three technologies is what SCIB1 is all about. That generates these potent T cells, which has this anti-tumor response. Now, Just to talk about study design, this is a phase 1-2 trial in patients with what are called stage 3 or stage 4 melanoma. These are late-stage patients who have metastasized, so they're at great risk of relapse. And you always have to start in cancer with patients who are very severely ill. So the first patients were inoperable. You couldn't operate on them. Very tough, immunocompromised. But even in those patients, we saw some benefits. But the real patients we wanted to treat were part two. These are stage 3-4 patients in whom you couldn't yet see any tumors in visceral organs and elsewhere. And the objective of this was to try and prevent recurrence and extend survival. And this is really the sweet spot. What we do is treat patients for 6 months with 5 injections, and we follow them up to see what happens to the disease, whether it recurs, and how long they live. This on the right-hand side is what an immunobody looks like. It's a re-engineered antibody, if anybody knows what an antibody is all about. And we put bits of the cancer antigen into the Y of this monoclonal antibody, and it becomes a vector for delivering those pieces to dendritic cells. So it's a very effective vector. Okay, the first thing to say is it's very safe. That's very important in cancer, particularly if you want to treat earlier stage patients. So we've treated patients now on 220 occasions or more, and as you would expect with a highly targeted vaccine treatment, vaccines in general are very safe, and we haven't seen any what are called grade 4 or grade 5 adverse events. The only adverse events you really see as a result of the injection. And when you inject with electroporation, you get a pretty tough hit on the arm or the leg, and it's painful for a while, but in 30 minutes you go home and you have no side effects. So most people are very happy to have that rather than have the debilitating effects of 3 weeks of infusions, for example, which you might have with a monoclonal antibody. The highlights are that of the 35 patients we have treated, 15 were these inoperable patients, and within those 15, very hard to treat patients with lung metastases in most cases, you can actually see those lung metastases disappearing from time to time. So this is when we knew we had an active drug. And even without checkpoint inhibitors, we can see a destruction of tumors in visceral organs like the lung. That was very exciting. But of the 20 patients we treated with late-stage metastatic disease, without these visible tumors, all 20 are still alive. This is phenomenal. These patients have now been treated for 3 years plus, and everyone is still alive. And every time we report this, it's for a longer period. Very, very exciting. We do immunology around these patients as well. 24 out of the 28 patients on which we've done immunology have terrific immune responses specifically against our target. The only ones who didn't respond were at the very lowest doses. So if you get to a therapeutic dose, they have an immune response. And importantly, from an immunological perspective, those immune responses persist. We know they persist for 2 years and beyond, and that's very important for keeping the disease at bay. This is the key slide that you should know about. These are our 20 patients with metastatic melanoma in whom the disease was cut out. We give them SCIB1, and then we see what happens. These are the 20 patients who are still alive. Of the 16 patients who received a somewhat lower dose, 2 to 4 milligram dose, all of them have now been treated for at least 3 years. They're all alive, and only 5 out of those 16 patients have any sign of disease recurrence. Someone is very tempted to talk about potential curative potential in these patients. So what you're doing, we believe, with these patients is seeking out and mopping up the micrometastases that you cannot see, but nevertheless in time would grow into a tumor. Very, very exciting. There's another 4 patients who are treated at a higher dose, which we think will be a better dose because it's giving a better immune response. Those 4 patients are all alive. They were treated later, so it's for a shorter period of time, and none have experienced any disease recurrence at this time. Very, very exciting, very, very motivating for us. Many of these patients are young with families who had to put their affairs in order and are still alive and well and getting on with their lives. And if any of you have seen some of our videos from Southampton with youngsters on BBC News, you'll know the practical consequences of it. This is an open study, so we have to compare with historical controls. No matter how you look at it, this slide attempts to look at historical controls. We would have expected a third to a half or even more of these patients to have died and many more to have progressed by this time. Nevertheless, the gold standard in pharma is a prospective randomized controlled clinical trial, and that's why we're doing this next step in the United States. There is a good deal of logic, as I said, to combining treatments. If you're talking about a vaccine with very potent T cells, you would expect to be able to eliminate micrometastases, so great for early tumors. For late tumors, you need something called checkpoint inhibition, because tumors, along with their other nasty qualities, manage to evade the immune system. They develop mechanisms for evading the immune system. So you have to unblock that evasion in order for the T cells to attack. And so for late-stage tumors, like the ones where we see all those lung tumors disappearing, we think you need to combine with a checkpoint inhibitor, and there's tremendous scientific evidence to suggest that that will be the case. We've done some of them. This is a slide in mice showing what happens when you don't treat them at all. That's the lower curve. If you use either SCIB1 or a checkpoint inhibitor in these animals, you prolong survival in some of the animals, but if you combine the two treatments, you keep 85% of the animals alive. This is just one of many experiments we've done and others have done, supporting the combination of SCIB1 with a checkpoint inhibitor. In this case, it's called an anti-PD-1 agent, which is a checkpoint inhibitor. So on the back of all of this, we want to do a clinical study in this combination. That's the one I mentioned that will start in 2017 in the US and complete in 2018. And the important thing from an investor perspective is checkpoint inhibitors are being developed by the major pharmaceutical companies. Six of them are fighting in the trenches already, two of them on the market, and all of them are looking for ways to differentiate their products from the competition. And the way to do it, we believe, is to get the best combination. So we think when we've done this, we will be very attractive to pharmaceutical companies, and I can tell you they're approaching us as we speak, and I got one new email this morning from a company I hadn't spoken to before. So people are recognizing our data, and they will respond, and there will be some point when we will do, I think, a very attractive deal. So in summary, how am I doing? Still okay? SCIB1, why does it stand out from this crowded, exciting field? One is our long-term clinical data. We've now treated patients for 4 years, approaching 5 years. We see fantastic survival data, fantastic progression-free survival data in late-stage patients. All of our resected patients with metastatic disease are still alive. Sooner or later, somebody is going to die, I know, but right now they're all still alive. And oncologists are quietly, they won't say it in public, they're quietly coming up to me and saying, Richard, you may have cured these patients, and that's a fantastic thing for late-stage melanoma. It's extremely safe. You compare it with all the other treatments on the market for melanoma in immuno-oncology. They're quite toxic still, and Yervoy, which is a BMS drug, is causing significant numbers of withdrawals despite being very effective. It's easy to manufacture, and that's in contrast to some of these cell therapy approaches that you might have heard about, very expensive. Direct injection into the body means it's simple even for a nurse to do. In the case of melanoma, that could be a dermatologist as well as an oncologist, so very attractive from that perspective. And it's widely conceded that the checkpoint inhibitors that only work, as I said, in 30% of patients will require something else to really treat the majority of patients. And we think we've got a great way of doing that. So the first short-term clinical driver for investors of real significance is going to be a readout from this study in 2018. The study is configured to increase response rates from 30 to 50%. That's 80 patients. We obviously hope we'll do better than that, but we expect that response rate to be achieved. I'll come on to the second point in a minute, as time is short. So the second technology is Modotope. It's preclinical. It's better than our scientific founder has ever seen for any immuno-oncology in treatment. I've tried to cut down the complexity of mechanism of action, and forgive me if I say something about it. It involves the characteristic of stress cells, and cancer cells are very stressed, of converting a protein, and particularly an amino acid within that protein called arginine, into another non-standard amino acid called citrulline. And this means that you can detect on the surface of the cell citrullinated epitopes, that is to say peptides of these proteins, to act as a marker for the immune system. And this is a novel discovery. And we are now using these citrullinated epitopes, these are peptides, which we manufacture, synthesize, and inject into mice at this point in order to accelerate this process of converting, of generating T cells specifically against these citrullinated epitopes, which then go and target those cancer cells and kill them. And I mean, it's a complicated mechanism to understand, but it's very, very effective. And we are seeing, in animals, complete resolution of tumors in very aggressive tumor models. So the line going down is what happens to animals with no treatment. We're combining various citrullinated epitopes together to create our first product. The top line is our first product, and we're keeping all these animals alive. And we're doing it, importantly, from a commercial point of view, without checkpoint inhibition. So this particular technology doesn't seem to need checkpoint inhibition, and therefore is a potential alternative for pharmaceutical companies that simply haven't got fast enough down the checkpoint inhibitor pathway. This is something completely new. Our first product is defined. It's called MODY1. MODY1 is going to go into clinical trials in breast and ovarian cancer from 2017. And that's simply because of the expression pattern on breast cancer and ovarian cancer cells that are particularly suited to these peptides. And if you look at triple negative breast cancer, this is breast cancer which is untreatable essentially with the currently available treatments. That's 20% of all breast cancer patients. There's a huge medical need. And ovarian cancer also, if it has progressed and is advanced, is also very hard to treat. So we're going to go into a clinical trial, 2017. These are advanced patients, so you can get a very quick readout. So we will get a very quick readout on whether this is working. And if it does, we think another very significant uplift. In terms of the science, you won't necessarily be familiar with this, but getting an article into a peer-reviewed top journal is not easy. And if you do it, you can have a very big tick against your technology. Cancer Research is the organ of the American Association of Cancer Research. Lindy and her colleagues in the labs have managed to get the science behind Moditope into Cancer Research with a full publication in December last year, and that is huge for us and the science, and that is a great door opener for pharmaceutical companies. So the second short-term clinical value driver for us is this second Moditope trial, two bites at the cherry. Each of these platforms is good for many other products apart from melanoma on the one hand and breast cancer and ovarian cancer on the other. So great platforms. They are different platforms. They're targeting different patients, different indications at different stages, so potentially complementary. So these are not things that are fighting each other. They're very complementary, and we hope they will both be equally effective. So that, in haste, I think I've hopefully kept to time, is the Scancell story. I hope you're as excited and passionate about it as we are. We're going to the United States to help create more value for shareholders as of now and during the course of the next couple of years. And please keep following us. Thank you.
Very well. I'm sure we've got some questions. Questions? Right at the back, standing up.
You mentioned the two trials upcoming in 2017, 2018. These, I assume, are not going to be cheap to fund. Is there any idea as to where?
Why am I not surprised that that's the first question?
Well, it's sort of integral, right?
Yeah. No, it's we're a biotech company, and whatever biotech company you are, whether you're Adaptimmune or whatever, you need to raise money to add value. We're very conscious of that. We are talking to potential investors in both the United States and the UK. And we're in a comfortable position with cash until the end of the year at the moment. Suffice to say, what I can say is that we will be making an announcement about how this work will be funded in the not-too-distant future.
I thought I saw one over there, blue jumper. And then there's one up the front afterwards.
Oh, that was a very good talk, Richard, considering what the gentleman asked. Are you considering collaboration with the bigger immuno-oncology companies, like Roche and Novartis, to help you in funding? AbbVie, Abbott, is that a...
Yeah, I mean, all of these companies are very good suggestions. I mean, all of the major pharmaceutical companies are seeking to establish a position in immuno-oncology. Some are there already, some aren't at all and need to get there. I think of companies like Eli Lilly, who are a long way behind. As I said, I even got an email, which I've barely had the time to read this morning, from a company I haven't had contact with.
Who was that company?
which I was very excited about, actually, because they do have a checkpoint inhibitor, and they're approaching me for exactly the reason I said, and that is, can you help us increase the efficacy of this agent? So we do get those. Anyone in my position is wary about predicting when you will close one or other of these deals. I mean, I've learned to be more cautious about that, but pharmaceutical companies don't always follow the time schedules that biotech companies would like. So, you know, if we can get money in from a pharmaceutical company, that would be fantastic, of course. But it may be this year, it may be next year, I don't know. It may be 2018.
Just one here in the second row, and then the last one. Just wait for the microphone, please.
I just wanted to clarify, and apologies if I missed it, are you, in your study, was it all melanoma primary from skin, or are we looking at other more rare ones like ocular and so forth?
No, this was all skin melanoma.
All skin melanoma.
So, and it was all black melanoma as well. It wasn't the white melanoma, the rarer white melanoma. So exactly so. We excluded ocular melanoma from the study, which is a different disease.
Okay, one more, the gentleman, the second one with the green shirt. That will have to be the last one.
Thanks, Richard. Would you be able to talk a little bit about the significance of the top two cancer hospitals in America agreeing to take part in the checkpoint inhibitor trial that you mentioned, the combination trial?
Well, we think it's huge. We think it's huge because until, shall we say, 9 months ago, no one had heard of us in the United States. And that was, I think, a bit of a mistake of ours that we didn't do this sooner. We didn't realize the significance and importance of engaging with top US opinion leaders. And I tell you, it's a little anecdotal, if I've got 2 minutes. The way this happened was we got an introduction to Keith Flaherty. And if you Google Keith Flaherty, you'll just see what a big guy he is in melanoma. And Lindy, the scientific founder, was with me at ASCO in June of last year. And these guys are all incredibly busy at that conference, as you could imagine. Everyone wants a piece. And we met them for breakfast, because Americans like to meet for breakfast, as you know, at 7 o'clock, thinking we'd have him for 20 minutes. And he engaged with us for 2 hours at ASCO and had to rush off at 9 o'clock and was fascinated by what we were doing. Didn't know anything about it because we hadn't spoken enough about it probably over there. And... that was the start of the relationship, and several months later, he'd agreed to be our principal investigator. And then, you know what happens? He picks up the phone to Sloan Kettering, it wasn't us, and says, you should have a look at this. So we've now got Paul Chapman at Sloan Kettering. You can look up Paul Chapman at Sloan Kettering. And then he phones up the University of Colorado and so on. And so that's how you build it. And... Now, we will continue building it. We will have probably 10 centers in the United States. We might have, there's still some of our centers in the UK who are very keen to participate in this too, including our principal investigator in Nottingham. So I think we'll have the UK as well. But that's how it came about.
And that's why you should always start the day on a good breakfast.
Porridge.
Well, yeah, porridge, right. Richard, absolute pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.